Welcome to Stories After Midnight. We will be reading a story called I Visited a Care Home, and There's Something Wrong with How They Dispose of the Bodies. It's a series, actually, so this is part one, and it's by Let's Split Up from Reddit. I hope you enjoy. There are all sorts of reasons you shouldn't visit Harmony Care Home. The first of which is that there's something very wrong with the people who spend their last days here. Many come, no one ever leaves. Not many names on the visitor log, but I am one of them. It's all a little hazy now, but as I remember it, from the moment I pull into the parking lot, a heavy sense of foreboding sends all the hairs on my neck standing on end, and I linger under the sign, neck craned to read, Harmony Care Home. Caring, compassionate, harmonious senior living. Pastel shades of orange outline the slogan, while yellow daisies around the border offer promises of sunshine. But the paint is chipped and faded, making the overall effect less care than tragic neglect, like a wedding gown eaten away by moths. Harmony Care Home? More like Ditch and Forget Home. I pull two cat carriers from the back seat of my car and stroll up the paved walkway across the grassy lawn. The moment I pass through the double doors, the chemical scent of cleaning supplies and Febreze wafts into my lungs, undercut by notes of something I can only describe as old, old age. I wrinkle my nose, but smile when the pretty blonde staffer looks up from the front desk. "Hello," she says. "Hello, I'm here to see Darlene Anderson." "And what is your relationship with Darlene?" The blonde's tag reads Lolita. "I'm her grandson, Jack." I'm not her grandson. In fact, I've never even met Darlene Anderson. But to explain our actual relationship would be complicated. Well, I guess it's not that complicated. I've scammed her out of a couple $1,000s through her cat rescuing. See, I'm actually more of a catfisher than a cat rescuer. Cat rescue groups are mostly comprised of middle-aged women like Darlene. So if you're a young grifter wanting to dip your sticky fingers in the donations pie, you'll do best to join under a sweet and dowdy name like, say, Suzanne. Call some kitty pictures from online, post some links to GoFundMes with sob stories. The cats did all right. My best fundraising scam was actually under the guise of Jacob, a little boy sick with cancer who got donations from hundreds of people all over the world. But then, some questionable life choices and a drug overdose put little Jacob into an actual hospitalization a couple months back. I woke up out of a coma to tons of messages from people worried about poor Jacob. Why no updates? Did he die? Meanwhile, the real me, Jack Wilde, was hovering near death with only the beeping of machines for company. Nothing like a near-death experience to make a man question his life choices. All of which is to say, I've given up on lies. Well, except to Lolita, just now about being Darlene's grandson. Anyway, I'm here because this morning I got a series of panicked messages on my old cat rescue profile. From Darlene. "Help, Mickle's very sick." Susan. "Oh no, I'm at work. Can your family help?" "Please, no one is helping. All those times I helped your cats, please remember. Jazz is dead. I think it's the cleaner they use." "Oh no, Jazz. What cleaners are they using?"
"Mickles keeps throwing up. When are you coming? Need you to take Mickles and Prometheus. Harmony Care Home. Need vet now."
"I'll send my son Jack. Hang in there."
Normally, when the victims of my grifts start asking me for favors in return, I ghost them. But Darlene's messages made it seem like an emergency, and I didn't have time to find anyone else to pick up Mickles and Pickles. Okay, it's Prometheus, but come on, it should obviously be Pickles. So yes, this time, I genuinely am in the role of a cat rescuer. I mean, sure, my entire relationship with Darlene is based on stealing her money, but Mickles needs a vet. Come on, I'm not a monster. And after I have these guys living that fancy feast life, if I inflate the vet bill a little when asking Darlene for reimbursement, well, who's the wiser? But now that I'm here at the desk signing in, there's just something about this place that prickles my skin.
And not just the smell, though the chemical odor is so strong it could strip flesh from bones. To the left of the check-in desk, a carpeted staircase leads to the upper floors, lit by electric lamps and sconces like old-fashioned torches. The dim lighting almost hides the horrible grim streaking the walls, and the even more alarming stains that darken the carpet. Is that black mold? Somewhere an old woman cackles, sings, sobs. Hard to tell. Hopefully not Darlene, though I'd hardly blame her. To the right sprawls a large common area with armchairs and sofas that exhale a puff of mildew-scented air when sat on. Note to self, don't do that again. There's tables with coffee, an old-fashioned jukebox, a chart with a calendar of events. Bingo is on for tomorrow, everyone. And trivia on Wednesday. Don't miss it. The common area actually looks fairly normal. Old folks sitting, chatting, watching television or sipping their coffee. They all seem pretty bored, but I mean, it's not bingo night. Once I finished signing in, Lolita points me up the stairs. I head up with my carriers, wrinkling my nose. Maybe it's just my own recent experience with hospitals and chemical cleaners that's making my skin crawl. Maybe there's nothing all that unusual about this place. Just a soul-sucking feeling of being forgotten. Up here, dusty windows let in pale sun, and the carpet is threadbare and the numbers on the doors faded, but it just seems like any old building. Except for the smell. That rank odor that even the chemicals aren't enough to cover up. A whiff of unwashed flesh, old urine, and something else. Something that conjures nightmares of maggot-riddled rotting meat. And then, I'm passing room 203. I notice the door is open, and that inside there is a man in a wheelchair who is visibly dead. I don't mean that he might be dead. No, I mean that I look in at a very old man who was obviously the source of the smell. He sits in a wheelchair, his head lolling to one side, ice blue eyes wide and vacant, and staring in the creepy way dead people's eyes do. I don't even think he just died. I think he's been dead a while, judging by the fluid puddling under his chair. It's surprising he doesn't smell even worse, but that must be all the chemicals that have killed my receptors. The guy looks like he was well over 90, so his kicking the bucket is not so surprising. But what does surprise me is that the staff have just left him here, exactly where, presumably, they must have found him, since he looks several days into decomposition. I guess I could go in and check his pulse to be sure, but also, are you kidding? No way. I do the only sensible thing, which is to report it to the front desk, but if he's been dead for days, shouldn't they already know? Pointedly ignoring the creepy whispers in my mind that tell me something is off about this whole place. Lolita blinks alarmed blue eyes. Oh my gosh, she exclaims. Let me call the nurse. Are you sure? You sure he wasn't sleeping? Room 203. He sleeps a lot. He's 100% dead, I assure her. Did you check? Did I check? Is that my job? Hello, do you think I go walking up to dead bodies checking them? I watched for a suitably long time to ascertain that he was not blinking or breathing. Yeah, he's dead. Okay, I'll have the nurse check on him right away. I leave her to summon the nurse and head back upstairs, giving 203 a wide berth, and down the hall to Darlene's room, right at the very end. Knock, then enter. Dust motes dance in the light through the broken window blinds. The woman in the ragged armchair offers a wide smile that lifts years from her face, so that for a moment she almost resembles the vivacious cat lady from her profile. With hokey sequined sweaters and glossy auburn curls. But besides the smile, she is so hauntingly different that I nearly don't recognize her. Her curls have gone greasy and limp. Her fingernails black with dirt as she picks at her withered skin.
Oh, you must be Jack. You don't look at all what I expected.
Yeah, I get that a lot. As a racially ambiguous Blasian, I look nothing at all like Susan. I say breezily, I'm adopted. Mom says hi. When did your cats start getting sick?
Oh, it was...
She trails off, tears welling.
Mickles is already gone.
Oh, I'm so sorry. She's already calling for Prometheus, clicking her tongue and waving a cat treat bag. I step over a spot of vomit when she asks me to check her bedroom closet, which I do, awkwardly making those pss-pss sounds. I've never been a cat person. Dogs are just objectively better. I find Prometheus hidden deep in the closet, orange and fluffy and growling. He bites me when I haul him out. "Good-looking guy," I tell Darlene, faking a smile as I shake my bloody hand. She clucks and tells me to get some bandages from the bathroom. Then she offers me tea, but I demur and head for the door, eager to escape the room's stench of cat piss. Then she asks a question that gives me pause.
"Jack, you're the one who was in a coma, right?"
Yeah. I'm surprised she remembers that.
"Did you get the flowers?"
"Yes, thank you."
"Good," she smiles. "You're taking care of yourself? Not making your mother worry too much?"
"Been trying to be better."
"Good," she nods. "She loves you very much, you know."
I do know, because I wrote all of Susan's communications and got a kick out of making her everything my real mom isn't. In reality, there's no family in my life. It was Darlene who messaged when I woke up out of my coma, asking Susan for help with a cat rescue. I ended up telling her how my son, Jack, had OD'd and was recovering in the hospital. And then Darlene sends flowers. Actual flowers. To real me. And even if it was under false pretenses, those flowers were the only thing in my hospital room besides the machines. And if you want to know, that's the real reason I'm here now to help her cats.
"You're a good kid, Jack," she says.
I tell her that I'll take good care of Prometheus. She gives me the saddest look, obviously trying not to cry as I take away the only thing she loves in that place. And then I shut the door, and Prometheus yowls like I'm breaking his little kitty heart. And I'm not crying. You're crying. Prometheus continues wailing as I start up the car. Loud, deep, mournful howls that shake his entire body.
"I know, buddy," I tell him.
What a way to go, eh? How does someone so loving and lively wind up trapped and abandoned in such a dismal room? I'm about to start the car, but now I'm thinking again about that resident up in 203. The guy in the wheelchair. Did the staff ever check on him? "Not my circus, not my monkeys." I set the car in reverse. But then, I drop my head back against the headrest. Sigh. Remember how it feels to be dying alone. Hooked up to machines. With no one caring. Getting those flowers. Prometheus howls. If I could translate those howls, they would be alone, alone, alone. Screw me. Back out of the car. Already regretting this. Slam door. Already hating every life choice that led me here. Stride back to the front entrance. My phone doesn't get cell reception out here. Of course it doesn't. And the spotty Wi-Fi can make video calls, but not regular cell network ones. Fine. I'll call the cops once I'm back on the road. But I should make sure he's actually dead, so I don't get accused of being a prankster. To get help for Darlene and other residents, I need evidence. Back through the double doors. Screw me. Screw me. I'll just get a few pictures, make a report, and keep myself out of it as much as possible. Fake contact info. No follow-up questions, please and thank you. Lolita at the front desk smiles and asks if I forgot something. I tell her I need to ask Darlene about Prometheus's diet. Then I add, "Hey, did you check that resident in 203?
Yeah, he's fine.
"Really?"
"Uh-huh."
Seeing my eyebrows arch toward my hairline, she adds,
"Gerard just needed to be changed. That's probably the puddle you noticed. He has kind of a mean stare and can look spooky, but he's more bark than bite."
"He didn't look spooky. He looked dead."
"He's just old,"
she shrugs apologetically. "Uh-huh. And my real name's Susan." I give her my biggest smile and say, "That's a relief. Whew. Guess I'm just not used to old people. More dead people." Which he is, Lolita. She waves me off and I head upstairs, every nerve tingling at that familiar, rotting odor that clings to my clothes. I pause at the door to 203, which is now closed. Glance up and down the hall, eavesdrop for a moment, No sounds. I turn the knob and it is not locked. I swing it open slowly and peer inside. There is no light in the room except for the illumination from the open door, and I almost scream because the beam falls squarely on two pinpricks of ice blue, staring vacantly out from the darkness. Jack, have you gone clinically insane? Why the hell are staff here telling you this old man is alive when he's obviously decomposing? What is going on at this care home? I do not wish to know the answers to any of these questions. It would be great to have somebody brave, somebody like, maybe, say, some boys and girls in blue with lights and sirens and guns come bursting in and wheel out poor Gerard. Maybe with hazmat suits, because what is that stuff leaking under him? That is not him messing himself. That is him. He is liquefying and... Whoa, what am I still doing here? Camera. Hurry the hell up, Jack. Camera. Before someone notices. Light. Light. I tap the light switch. It doesn't work. Of course it doesn't. Why would it? Maybe I need to get the lamp cord. I step over, pull the cord on the lamp on the small table in the cluttered room with all its old person's stuff. A warm, fuzzy yellow light illuminates a maggot wriggling in Gerard's left eye, and I gag, holding my shirt over my nose with my eyes watering and stomach bucking. Close the door so no one in the hall notices me, effectively entrapping me in here with this corpse. Great. Just great. And then I get out my phone. Open the camera app. Creak. Ice claws up my spine. I look over my shoulder and... What the hell? I whispered. Was Gerard's chair facing me before? Did he just move? No. Screw you, Gerard. Can a dead body move? Oh, hell, I whisper, every muscle taut. Still, I aim the camera at him and snap pictures. Gerard, the room, a syringe somewhere in the corner for medicine, probably, or poison, who knows. Just get the evidence so the cops come and then get out. Jack, get out of here in the next 3 seconds and run and never come back. I've got the photos, but shouldn't you, says a small inner voice that I hate right now, check that he's actually dead? No. To hell with you, voice. I don't need to check. But of course, the clever inner voice that is always thinking ahead knows that if the cops come and he's alive, they won't believe me about Darlene. And everything in me is screaming that this is a terrible idea. But I inch closer, hovering my hand over his nostrils because if he's breathing, I'll know he's alive. And in this dim light of the lamp, I just can't tell. 1, 2, 3. 5, 10, 20 seconds, no breath. I reach to check the pulse of his neck. His hand shoots out, grabbing my wrist. I scream, not a manly scream either, a high-pitched, terrified, totally lost it little girl shriek. I swear to God my soul leaves my body. And then I jerk back harder than I intend, and his grip is stronger than I expect, with the result I actually yank him right out of his chair and onto the floor. I wrench my arm free and scramble back toward the door. And Gerard's head snaps up, that maggot falling out of his melting left eye. Oh God. And there's a strange pale light in his pupils, and he lunges, crawling with inhuman speed toward me. Hell! I bolt out of the door, slamming it shut, and hold it. I think I might have pissed myself. I sink against it, hyperventilating, and inside hear creaking as he gets back into his wheelchair. Hell. Hello? It is Lolita. Oh, hi, Lolita. Sorry about the piss. Don't mind me. I think I'm about to faint. Hey. I gasp. Are you all right? What's going on? Her pretty forehead knits in concern. Gerard wanted to play tag. What? She opens the door and looks in, and I scramble to the side, ready for him to leap out. And all so fully ready to sacrifice her and shove her into him. What? She's clearly braver than I am. From my brief glimpse of the interior, Gerard is back in his wheelchair, and it's as if he's never moved. Lolita smiles and waves. Hi, Gerard. Gerard does not respond. Girl, he dead. He's so dead. She looks at me, looks at my trousers, wrinkles her nose a little. "Bathroom is down the hall," she informs me.
Sorry. Can I ask, is everyone here, sane?
I point sort of generally all around and then at her.
Are you? Am I sane?
She seems amused.
Uh-huh.
It's a serious question, Lolita.
I mean, I think so. You're the one acting strange. Didn't you just come to collect Darlene's cat? Why are you bothering Gerard? You seem kinda easily spooked.
I am not easily spooked. Oh, I'm not saying I'm brave. There is no universe in which Jack is a hero. But I have been through enough in my life to have a very keen sense of danger. And only genuinely spooky things spook me. And also, I know when I'm being gaslit. I wrinkle my brow and say, I guess so. Well, guess I'll be on my way. Don't forget to sign out, she adds. Then as I'm down the hall,
oh, and if you visit again, make sure to always sign in first, all right? The nurses might confuse you for a patient if you forget.
Confuse me for a patient? I echo. This just keeps getting better.
So, what are they gonna do? Sedate me?
She giggles. Screw it. I'm out. I'm done. I am out. When I get home, I open up the photos, fully intending to text them to the police and then squint, swear softly under my breath. Every single photo is blurred or blacked out. Every single one. You can't make out any details. Not Gerard's dead face or obviously decaying body or eye maggot or anything. It could be my lens, but I snap a selfie and it comes out clear. Snap a shot of Prometheus yowling, also clear. Turn the lights off and snap several more, all three dim but clear. But everything inside of Harmony Care Home? My skin crawls with that unbearable tingle that happens whenever I'm exposed to something that defies the natural order. The last time I encountered something like this, it put me in a coma. So do the smart thing, Jack. Don't get involved. Darlene isn't family. You don't have family, remember? Gotta look out for number one. But you know who does have family? Darlene. Let them take the risk rescuing her. My inner voice offers cowardly but sensible advice. I find Darlene's granddaughter, Emma, on Instagram. Message her, telling her to get her grandmother out of Harmony Care Home. It's an emergency. She says she'll be out tomorrow. Then I call the police. I tell them I saw a patient assaulted and in need of medical help. His name is Gerard. They need to bring him to the hospital and be wary of the staff. They're covering up whatever's going on there. I spend about an hour making all these calls. And you know what comes of all that? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. The police don't do a damn thing. Darlene's family doesn't pull her out. She's still trapped there, frittering away her last days alone. Nobody visits at Harmony Care Home. I know because I saw the visitor's log. The last name before mine, Darlene Marie Anderson. 2 weeks ago, she wasn't a resident. She was the most recent previous visitor. And unfortunately for both of us, the only person she has who might be able to save her is me. That's it. I really hope you enjoyed that story. It looks like it's going to be about 6 parts, so I really hope I'll see you in the next one. And I really appreciate you listening. Huge shout out to my patrons for helping make this video possible. Their generosity really, really goes a long way, and I hope you know you're appreciated. Also, thank you for listening. I really appreciate it. If you'd like to, you can come hang out in our Discord. It's pretty low-key, won't take up much of your time. And if you fancy yourself a writer, you can send your stories to me at storiesaftermidnight.com. There's a link there that will send you to a form. And that's basically about it. So without further ado, I hope you're having a great day. And we will see you in the next part. Take care now. Bye-bye then.